Welcome to the channel Get Rich. Today the company we are going to analyze is Eicher Motors. So first, the business of Eicher Motors. So Eicher Motor Limited has two different business units. So the first one, the main one, is Royal Enfield. So Royal Enfield is the oldest motorcycle brand in continuous production. Royal Enfield range of motorcycles is able to address a unique mix of appeals from its traditional customer base to urban aspiration driven youth. So they have three different subsidiaries, wholly owned subsidiaries, one in North America, one in Thailand, and one in Brazil. So they also have other business unit, which is a joint venture with the Volvo Group. So they have holdings of around 54.4% and Volvo Group has around 45.6%. So it is called VE Commercial Vehicles. So what do they manufacture? They have Eicher trucks and Eicher buses, and they also have Volvo trucks. So let's first look into the business of Royal Enfield. So they sold 8,23,828 motorcycles in financial year 2019. So it literally, they increased the sales 7 times in the last 7 years. So it is grown at a CAGR of around more than 30%. Also, if you look at the Royal Enfield market share in the mid-size motorcycle segment. So what do I mean by mid-size motorcycle? So mid-size motorcycle ranges between 250cc to 750cc. So they have a market share of more than 90% in India. It's very, very huge. They have a huge market dominance in this segment. And if we look into the EBITDA of Royal Enfield, since they are in a premium brand, they have a very high profitability. So it's around 30.1%, which is Royal Enfield EBITDA margin. That's a benchmark in the automobile industry. So also, if you look at VE commercial vehicles market share in domestic LMD, which is light and medium duty segment, they have a market share of around 29.4%. Also, if you look at Eicher Motor Limited, it continues to be a debt-free company. They don't have any debt. So let's look into the global motorcycle industry. So in this chart, you are seeing the global motorcycle industry volume in millions. So India continues to be the dominant market in global motorcycle industry. So India has around 19 million of motorcycle units sold. It also includes tricycles and other some other small segments. So it's not exactly motorcycles, but it gives us more or less a good overview of the number. So it's around 19 million in India, and for China accounts for around 16.5 million, and then comes Indonesia around 6 million, and then Vietnam, and then Philippines, and then Thailand, Pakistan, Brazil, Mexico, and Taiwan. Eicher Motors is a dominant player in India. They are also doing exports, and they have also entered into Thailand, Brazil. If you look at the whole automobile units which are sold in 2019 in the entire globe, it's around 60 million, so it's around 6 crores. Then if you look at the global motorcycle segment breakdown, so out of this 6 crore motorcycle units sold in the entire world, 70% of them are below 125cc segment. And then another 25% lies in 125 to 256cc segment. And then we have above 250cc segment, which is 5%. So Royal Enfield plays in this particular segment, which is 5% of 6 crore. So which is around 30 lakhs units is the global entire sales. And they already have around 8.2 lakh selling in only in India. So if we take a rough calculation, they have around 25 to 27% of entire global sales. So that's already a considerable market dominance. So remember this number. I will come back to this number in the later stage. The motorcycle volumes in India. So it is, this number comes only for motorcycles. So in financial 15, we have around 10.7 million. And then in financial 19, it's around 13.6 million units only in India. So it's continuously growing. So if you look at the growth in Indian market, so up to 125cc, in financial 2015, it dropped around 1.8%. But at the same time, above 125cc, it grew to 25% growth. And then in financial 16, up to 125cc, degrow by around 2%. And above 125cc, it's growing around 6.6%. Financial 17, the same trend, 21% for above 125cc. Financial 18, up to 125cc is growing at 15%. Also above 125cc is growing at around 9.5%. And then in financial 19, up to 125cc 7.6%, above 125cc 8.3%. What does this graph tells us? Indian market is growing towards premiumization. Then if you look at the developing markets and mature markets, so in developing markets, less than 250cc, it degrow by 2%. In between 250 to 750cc, which is a mid segment, which is the Royal Enfield operating in this segment, and it grown around 3%. Above 750cc, it degrown by 2%. If you look at the mature market, less than 250cc, degrown by 3%, greater than 750cc, degrown by 1%, but the mid-size segment, 250 to 750cc, it's growing 5%. If you look at the some of the markets, so as I said, Royal Enfield has higher ambitions to move towards Brazil and also Colombia and some Latin American markets and also Thailand. So here in the graph, you are seeing the breakdown of Brazil market. So in Brazil, 30% of the automobiles sold is scooters and others, and less than 250cc bikes accounts for around 56%. But the mid-size segment, 250 to 750cc, which accounts for 12%, greater than 750cc, 2%. So they have a sizable market. If you look at Colombia, so they have only 4% in 250 to 750cc. Compared to the world, it's a pretty small market. Let's look at the business of Royal Enfield. So as I said, Royal Enfield is the oldest motorcycle brand in continuous production. They have a various range, ranging from traditional iconic motorcycles to urban life cycle and now even adventurous motorcycles. So they have a wide products range. So first one is Bullet, longest production motorcycle, and it's a pride of the armed forces. They also have Royal Enfield Classic, and they introduced Royal Enfield Thunderbird. It has a long range and load bearing capabilities, and then they introduced Himalayan, which is especially built for exploring the Himalayas, so it's versatile for riding on and off road. And they also introduced two new motorcycles, Continental GT and Interceptor. So these are powered by modern twin cylinder engine, and they have a huge traction and demand for these motorcycles, even in Indian market and also in global market. So it won a lot of awards. It has a very good reviews, and it has a huge demand in the market. So they are doing very great with the product. They try to not only sell motorcycles, but to sell the lifestyles like productive riding apparel, urban casual wear and personal accessories, and also touring seats, productive engine and leg guards, luggage solutions and controls. They have a wide range of apparel solutions as well. So they have built a brand around this. And they also recently introduced Make Your Own, which is personalization of motorcycles with factory fitted accessories. So Make Your Own, a first of its kind initiative, allowing a buyer custom build a motorcycle with choice of accessories at the time of booking the motorcycle. Initially, it is available under select classic 350 variants in 6 cities, and they want to roll it out in the future for other products and other regions. Then let's look at their sales. So from commercial 2006, so they were growing around 7%, 13%, 18%, 20%, and then in 2010 around 1%. Then they launched Classic in 2009, and they launched other Thunderbird and apparel and accessories in 2012, and they launched Continental GT in 2013, and they launched Himalayan in 2017. So they are constantly releasing their own products. And if you look at the growth from 2011 to 2016, they are growing at 42%, 52%, 57%, 70%, 68%. This is huge growth. So did their stock price. It went so high, it was doing pretty good. But then if you look at the financial 17, 18 and 19, it went down to 31% and then 23% and then now 0%, as the stock price also did the same. The street is expecting it to grow at a much higher pace, and their growth is coming down. That's a bad sign, because they were a very huge growth company, and they grown their market share to more than 90% in their mid-size segment, and then now it is decreasing. But then it's not just Royal Enfield, it's throughout the industry there is a sales drop. So also they have other problems like BS6 emission norms. So what is BS6? The Indian government announced new emission norms, which is BS6. So they want to all the vehicles needs to be transformed to BS6. So that was also the challenge the entire automobile industry was facing. Then if you look at the sales, 10 month sales in financial 2019, it's 7 lakh, around 7 lakh. If you look at the 10 month financial 20, it's just 6 lakhs. So it's a 15% reduction in sales. If you look at their export volume, exports around 9360 number in 2016. In financial 2017, it's around 15,000. In 2018, it's 19,000. Financial 2019, 20,000. Look at financial 2020, it's grown to 36,000 in just 9 months. So this is mainly because of this, their twin bikes. So they launched two new 650cc twin bikes, and that is doing very well in the export market. If you look at the market share of Royal Enfield in the total Indian volume of motorcycles, so it's around 5.9% in 2018. It's a percentage of all the total vehicles sold in 2019. Then if you look at the market of above 125cc, so Royal Enfield has a market share of around 25.7% in financial 2020. So it's a very high number. Then if you look at the mid-size segment greater than 250cc, they are the market leader. They have around 96% percentage of market share they are having in this particular segment. That is a very, very good thing. On the other side, they are already at the region of 96%. So now they can only grow together with the industry, not they cannot increase their market share any much further. So it's much difficult for them to grow. I will come to that also in the upcoming section. If you look at their brand building activities, they are doing Rider Mania 2019. So they organize these kind of events that provides their that provides edge to them building their brand. And they are also doing Himalayan Odyssey 2019, and they attracted a lot of Royal Enfield riders. And then they also did Royal Enfield Himalayan Adventure in 2019, and also they also present in many markets. So one of them was Australian Motorcycle Festival. They also present in Thailand, Brazil, in a lot of other countries as well. Let's have a look at the key markets in India. So in India, if you look at the industry, so these are the states which are very key markets for the automobile industry for motorcycles. So UP, 18% share of sales for the industry is from UP. So if you compare it to the Royal Enfield, they have around 13%. In MP, it's around 8%, and they are around 4%. In Bihar, the industry, it's around 8%, they are around 5%. So what does this graph tell? So in these key markets, they are still underpenetrated. They are not up to the industry though. So they have still some room to grow in these markets. Also, if you look at the other side of the segment, so they have in these states, they have a very high market share. In Goa, they have around 35% market share. In Kerala, 33%. Chandigarh, 25%. Delhi, 17%. Punjab, 12%. Tamil Nadu, 7%. Overall, they have around 6%. So it's a these states, they have higher penetration. Also, if you compare the lower penetration state, if you look at Rajasthan, they just have 2%. MP, they just have 3%. Bihar, they just have 3%. Gujarat just 4%, UP 4%, AP 4%, overall is 6%. So in these states, they have a huge growth. They can increase their market share much better. They are also increasing dealerships, and they are trying to increase the market share in these particular states. So they still have growth in our country. So these are the underpenetrated states for Royal Enfield. Then if you look at the market share increase over the period, so if you look at UP, they increase their share from 1% to 4%. In MP, 1% to 2%. Bihar, 1% to 4%. Rajasthan, 1% to 3%. Tamil Nadu, 2% to 9%. Karnataka, 3% to 7%. So in all these states, they are constantly increasing their market share. They are doing pretty good. They are growing much faster and gaining market share like anything from many different players. If you look at the average selling price of Royal Enfield, so it was steadily increasing from quarter 1 financial 18 to quarter 1 financial 20. It was increasing from around 1.1 lakh rupees to around 1.3 lakh rupees. Currently, it stays around the same. They are selling around 1.3 lakhs rupees. So what is ASP? Is average selling price. So they are, what is their average selling price of a bike? So they are selling at around 1.3 lakhs now. Then if you look at their motorcycle breakdown, so first let's look at the domestic market. So 250 to 350cc segment, they sold around 182,832 volume in quarter 3 financial 2019. In quarter 3 financial 20, it reduced to 167,593. This is 250 to 350cc market. Then if we come down to 350 to 500cc motorcycles, they sold 7,310 in financial year 2019. And then in quarter 3 financial 20, they sold around 3,251. So it degrown by around 55%, 350 to 500cc. But then 250 to 350cc, it just reduced by around 8.3%. It's understandable. The higher the premium in this market, yeah, this segment will have a higher impact. So then if you look at 500 or 800cc, they just have 954 in quarter 3 financial 19 and then 3475 in quarter 3 financial 20. It increased around 264%. Look at that. This is mainly because of their 650 twin bikes. People love it. Many people have very, very good reviews and most of the people want to buy them who are capable of buying. So it's a very, very good thing for them. This product is a groundbreaking product for them. Then if you look at the export, so the total export in quarter 3 financial 2019, it's 3,377. In quarter 3 financial 20, it's 8,472. It increased by around 151%. In these times, domestic market degrow, but their export is growing around 150%. Of course, it's from the lower number, so but still they are growing at around 151% in these times. And 350 to 500 cc segment, they sold around 2281 to 2889. It increased in quarter 20. So if we look at 250 to 350 cc, they just sold 387 in quarter 3 financial 2019 to 656 in quarter 3 financial 2020. Then 350 to 500 cc, it's around 2281 to 2889. Then 500 to 800 cc, it increased from 709 to 4927. Look at that growth. It grew around 600%. So look at the demand they have for this product. So mainly domestic market, 250 to 350 cc dominates the market. For export, 500 to 800 cc dominates the market. Let's look into their presence. So they have a global presence. So they have their corporate office in India, Gurgaon. And then they have their manufacturing facilities in Chennai, in Tiruvottiyur, Oragadam, Vallam, Vadakkal. So they have in these places, they have their manufacturing facilities and they have two technological centers. So one in India and one in UK. And they also have a lot of dealers. So their dealer network in India, it's around, they have a large format stores and they also have a studio format stores. So in large format stores, they have around 939 stores and in studio stores, they have around 500. They plan to increase the studio stores to 750 in March 2020. So already they would have increased to 50 studio stores. And then if you look at the number of permanent employees, they are around 4,732. And if you also look at Royal Enfield exclusive stores overseas, they are around 767 exclusive stores. If you look at the commercial vehicle business, until now we were talking about the Royal Enfield bike. Now they also have other business, which is commercial vehicle business together with Volvo. So they have light and medium segment, which is Eicher Pro 1000 series. They have around 3.5 to 15 ton. Also they have Eicher Pro 3000 series, which is 12 to 15 ton. So their volumes, they sold around 34,688 in financial 2019. In financial 20, it's 25,900. It degrew a lot. Also commercial vehicle segment took a pretty big knock. It's also reflecting in their business as well. If you also look at their heavy duty segment, so they have Pro 8000 series and Pro 6000 series. So the Pro series is gaining more traction with increased interest in technologically advanced trucks. So the Volvo trucks are witnessing good acceptance in the market. If you look at their buses, they have an Eicher bus. So they have Eicher Skyline, Eicher Starline, and they also have a new electric bus. So their volumes are around 9132 in 10 month financial 2019 and it reduced to 8581 in financial 2020. They also have Volvo trucks in niche segments. So they have leadership in niche segments. They have 55 ton dump trucks. They have mining tipper, tunnel tipper, over dimensional cargo. So FH520 is the flagship model of the Volvo truck range. So they also have these kind of niche segments. So also volumes, they have around 935 in 10 month financial 2019 and 937 in 10 month financial 2020. It is staying around the same. If you look at their volumes, so their total commercial vehicle volumes, they sold around 72,969 in financial 2019 and 9 month financial 2020, they have around 37,000. In compared to the previous year, it's 15,959. It degrew a lot. Also the industry degrew, so it's not just them degrew, so it's not a big concern, but it's still affecting their bottom line. So it's still a concern. We have to look into the valuations considering all these effects. So also they have Eicher light to medium duty trucks, they have a heavy duty trucks, they have buses, they also have exports and Volvo trucks. So then now we saw the volume, but then what do they mean? So we need to know their market share in their particular segments. So Eicher heavy duty trucks, they have around market share of 4.9%. Eicher light and medium duty trucks, they have market share of around 28.7%. Buses, they have around 14%. It degrew for some time, but then it's 13.9% market share. So total commercial vehicle market share, including exports, it's 14.5%. That's a considerable market share. They are a pretty big player in this market. But then if you look at their manufacturing plant, so they have a manufacturing plant in India, mostly in Karnataka and Madhya Pradesh. They have several manufacturing plant. So they have a capacity to produce up to 90,000 trucks from single plant. So they have a plan to have construct a new plant, which is under progress, to take capacity to 130,000 per annum. So their highest ever production is 73,619 vehicles in financial year 2019. So they have a highly flexible vehicle assembly lines with the right blend of technology to control critical parameters, catering over 800 plus variants. So that's a good thing. They have a state-of-the-art bus plant spread over 46 acres, set up under VECV's overriding vision of driving modernization of Indian CV market. And then if you look at their distribution network, so Eicher truck and bus network, they have all over India presence. Volvo truck and bus network, they also have a lot of presence in India. Then if you look at their average selling price for the trucks, so in quarter one financial 18 around 16 lakhs, and now it stands around 17 lakhs. So that's it's pretty flat. It's not a huge increase, but still it increased a bit. If you look at their other business, so they have a powertrain business. They have a first engine plant in India producing Euro 6 compliant base engine. So they have an exclusive manufacturing hub for medium duty engine requirements of Volvo Group. So they have a current capacity of 50,000 engines, scalable up to 1 lakh engines. This is the best executed project with Volvo Group technology with frugal approach. The 5 and 8 liter engine of this platform delivers power ranging from 180 to 350 hp. So they have a lot of customers for this powertrain. So it's Escorts, Atul, Tafe, Voltas, Godrej, Mahindra. They have a lot of different customers, Caterpillar. So they are selling it to different people. So they are a strategic supplier of driveline components and aggregates for VECV, the Volvo Group, exports and strategic domestic OEM customers. So they have production facilities at Thane, Divas and SES. So their annual turnover is around 1000 crores in financial 2019. So these are their engine and powertrain business, and then they also have non-automotive engine business. So they have presence in 10 countries, genset assembly in UAE and South Africa, pan-India presence in genset segment. They have a reputed as most reliable and lowest operating cost engines established in material handling segment, engines and driver lines and drive lines for power, industrial and other off-highway applications. Then let's look at their growth opportunities. What are their growth opportunities looking forward? So if you look at the Indian demographics, 62% of people have age around 15 to 59, and 28% of people are 0 to 14. Only 9% 60 plus and 1% 80 plus. So they have a huge potential for them, because these people can buy a lot of premium bikes, because now a lot of people lies in economy class, so they can improve it to a lot of premium bikes in the future if they have a purchasing power. Growth in urbanization. So in 2001, only 21% of total population is urbanized. Now in 2020, it's around 32%. They see people are becoming urbanized people, and they will buy premium bikes, and their lifestyle will improve, and they have a high lifestyle, and then they will come to premium brands. We have a spending. In 1992, 59% of spending is basic spending. Only 41% is discretionary spending. In 2000, it increased to 46% and basic is only 54%. 2010, basic is just 41%, 59% is discretionary spending. In 2020, only 33% is basic and 67% is discretionary spending. People are willing to put a lot of money for premium brands and having lesser activities and other things. So it's a good thing for the company, because they are operating in a premium segment. So let's look at the premiumization of Indian motorcycle market. So in financial year 2014, only 15.6% is premium and all the other is economy, executive 100, executive 125. If you look at financial 2020, 23% are premium segment. So look at the growth in premiumization of motorcycle market in India. So it's increasing, so it's good for the company. And then if you look at their dealership expansion, in financial 2017 they have 675 normal stores, in financial 2020 they have 950 normal store, and in top of that they have 750 studio stores. So it's a very good thing, they now they can reach more customers in more cities and they can increase their sales. This is also one of the growth opportunities. They have a new 650 twin motorcycles. Out of these sales of this particular segment, 55% came from key metro cities, 45% in rest of India. So this twin motorcycle have a lot of potential in both domestic market and also in the global market, the export. But then they have a growth, but can they grow at 50%, 60%, 70% in the future? Like before, they were doing past 3-4 years, they were growing at around 50%, 60%, 70%. Do I believe till they can grow at 50%, 60%, 70% in the future? The answer is no. Why? Because the entire global market for this premium 250cc to 750cc is around, because we just had a number, so we had 6 crore motorcycles in total globe, and 5% is premium segment. So we just had 30 lakhs of premium motorcycle selling every year. Royal Enfield is already selling 8.25 lakhs. So can they increase their market share like before? The answer is no. And also, if you look at the motorcycle market, India is the top market. So out of 60 million, India accounts for 19 million. So the industry itself already have a lot of presence compared to the global sales. So if we just compare that to a four-wheeler, for example, four-wheeler market, out of the four-wheeler market, China have sales of around 27 million and then India just lies around 3 million. So look at the difference. But in motorcycle, already India surpassed China, but in four-wheeler, India is still lagging behind. So I feel four-wheeler have very high growth compared to the motorcycle segment, because motorcycles are already highly penetrated in India. That's my personal opinion. So you can have contradicting thoughts. But then I feel the growth in motorcycle segment is comparatively less compared to the four-wheeler segment. So also, when the people have higher purchasing power, they can move from motorcycles to cars. Also, that shift can happen, because it happened in both in USA and Europe when they are transferring from developing to developed nations. So they have a shift from a lot of motorcycles to a lot of cars. So that can also happen. Also, other thing, a lot of competitions are coming in. India has now 11 premium bike makers, while there are only 6 mass segment two-wheeler manufacturers. However, these 6 bike makers are also upping their strategy for premium bikes. So look at the competition. Already the market is very, very small. So if you just look at the number, so the motorcycle market of India, so India is selling about 20 million two-wheelers every year. And also the premium means like greater than 200cc or 250cc. India has just 7% of the total domestic market is premium bikes. And look at the competitions. That's a very, very bad sign, because a lot of competitions are coming in. So also the latest Bajaj have a collaboration with the Trimpa, and they are also emerged as a new competitor. So a lot of competition for a very, very niche segment. It is going to grow. I'm not saying it's going to degrow or it's not going to flourish, but it's going to grow, but at a much lesser pace than before. So it is going to grow at around 10% or 12% or that's a realistic estimate. Then they are going to grow at around 30% or 40%. So they cannot grow like before around 40%, 50%. They can grow at around 10% or 12% with the industry. That's my personal opinion. You can have contradicting thoughts. Move on to their net revenue from sale of spare parts, apparel and services. So they have around 579 crores in 2016 and 17 from these spare parts, apparel and services. In financial 2017 and 18, they have around 841 crores. In financial 2018 and 19, they have around 1039 crores. They are increasing their apparel and services business as well. That's a very good thing for the company. It can also provide a huge growth opportunities. Let's look at their financial of Royal Enfield. So they have a total revenue of around 9,794 crores And in 9 month financial 2020, it's around 6,898 crores. So it is reducing. As I said, they have a problem with the industry, so it's reducing. And if you look at the EBITDA margin, it reduced from 31% to 30% to now 25%. That's also another worrisome thing, because now they have BS6 norms and they have a higher manufacturing cost. They need to pass on to the customer. They cannot pass on everything at once. So that's already a overhang. So because if they just increase their price, the customers can move on to other brand. Reducing EBITDA margin is also a worrisome concern. And also I feel EBITDA margin is going to stay at around 25%. They are not going back to 30-31%. I feel they are going to stay at around stable 25% in the upcoming years. And then if you look at their net revenue from domestic business, it's around 9,400 crores. Their international business is just 379 crores in 2018 and 2019. Though they are growing much higher, their revenue base are pretty small. And if you also look at the profit after tax, so it's 2,054 crores in financial year 2019. Now 9 month financial 20, it's just 1,558 crores. It also reduced. That's not a good sign at all. And then if you look at the financial for the commercial vehicles, so their total revenue is 11,600 crores in financial 2019. In 9 month financial 2020, it's around 6,400 crores. That's a pretty huge beating. So that's also a worrisome concern. Also, if you look at the EBITDA margin, it was around 7.9%, 9%, 8%, and now it's just 5.7%. That's because they lost sales, but still it's a very, very less number. 5.7% is pretty less margin. And also, if you look at the profit after tax, they were doing at around 350 crores in financial 2017, 472 crores in financial 2018, and 475 crores in financial 2019, and in 9 month financial 20, just 84 crores. Look at that. That's a pretty huge fall. If you look at the balance sheet of Eicher Motors, so they have around total assets of around 11,410 crores in March 2019. So they are growing steadily and huge, very fast, and they have no debt. They are a debt-free company, and they have reserves of around 8,900 crores, and they have around 5,000 crores in investments. They are getting other income from mutual fund and fixed deposits income, and they also have a huge cash in hand. So they are a very, very good company. If you look at their net fixed asset, it increased pretty constantly, and the net worth, they increased from 3,600 crores to 8,900 crores. Their book value also increased from 1,300 rupees to 3,270 rupees. And then if you look at the shareholding pattern, 49.28% is the promoter holding, and mutual fund holds around 8.5%, and FII is holding around 27.71%. If you look at the rent of promoter, it's pretty constant, and also the FII plus DII, they increased a bit, but not a lot. Then if you look at the top 10 shareholders, so we have Virtus Vontable Emerging Market Opportunities, so they have around 1.1% total shares held, and Motilal Oswal Multicap 35, they have around 1.08% of total shares held. But then if you look at the total assets, they have 4.23% of their total assets in the total fund. They put it in Eicher Motors. They have huge confidence in Eicher Motors. And then we have, you have ICICI, Vanguard, SBI, ICICI, and SBI Blue Chip, Mirae Asset Large Cap Fund. So there are many funds they invested in this company. And if you look at the valuation, so this is Eicher Motors standalone valuation, not considering the commercial vehicle business segment. So if you look at the Eicher Motors standalone business, in financial 2016, they are doing around 6,000 crores. And in financial 2020, they are doing it around 9,400 crores. They have a huge increase in revenue. But then in financial 2021, I am projecting they are going to degrow by 5%. And in financial 2022, they are going to grow at 10% and 12%. So I feel at the end of financial 2023, they will be doing it around 11,000 crores of sales. And in net profit, if you look at net profit in financial 2016, so they have around 1,309 crores. And they are going to do at around 2,038 crores in financial 2020. So I am projecting it to 2,336 crores in for financial 2023. So they are going to degrow their net profit by 7% in 2021, 10% they are going to increase into 2022, and 12% increase in 2023. So let's look at the price target with current valuation. So this is just standalone business. So don't feel that this is the final target for the Eicher Motors as a company. So this is just the standalone business. So for the standalone business, the 1 year target is 12,477, 13,754 is 2 year, 15,405 is 3 year. This is just with the current valuation. The price cumulative growth, that is going to degrow by 10%, by 1% in 2 years, in 3 year 11% growth. So if you look at the PE of 21, because they are trading at around much higher valuation, so they were trading at around 30, 40 at some point, because that valuation was because they were growing at a much higher pace. Now I feel they cannot grow at that pace anymore. So I'm estimating their target with a PE of 21. So in 1 year, 14,557. In 2 years, 16,046. In 3 years, 17,972. So the price cumulative growth is 5%, 16%, 13%. This is just standalone business. So let's have a look at valuation of VECV. So their net profit for the first year, it is just 54% is held by Eicher Motors. So 81 crores for 1 year, 130 crores for 2 year, 189 crores for 3 year. So the price value at PE of 15, so it's 1200 crores, 1950 crores and 2835 crores. Right, if we calculate price per share of Eicher Motors, so 1 year it's 445, 2 years 714, 3 years 1038. So now let's go back to the valuation of Eicher Motors consolidated valuation. So Eicher Motors standalone price for with P21, they have 1 year 14,557, 2 year 16,000 and 3 year 18,000. And if you have a consolidated Eicher price target, so I have a price target of 15,000 for 1 year, 16,760 for 2 year, 19,000 for 3 year. So the with a price cumulative growth of 8% for 1 year, 21% for 2 year and 37% for 3 year. There is not a huge growth opportunity in this company. So it's a very good company. I feel confident with this company. They are going to grow their sales. So they are going to do 10%, 12%. It's a pretty good company, debt-free company. You can invest in this company if you don't want to have a huge growth. You just have a stable around 5% or 10%. Around if you can get 40% in 3 years. I will not invest in this company now because they have a near-term problem. They have this situation, this coronavirus crisis. And they cannot sell much at this point of time, and the industry volume sales is coming down. So in this scenario, I will not invest in this company at this current price. This is not my recommendation. You can do your due diligence before buying or selling any share. So if you already own this share, you can continue to hold. It's a very good company, but then I would not recommend to put your fresh money now with this current price in the company, because the growth opportunity is pretty limited. As I said before, there are other very, very good opportunities compared to this particular opportunity. So this is my personal opinion. But then if the price share comes down, now currently it's around 13,800 rupees. So if it comes down to 10,000 rupees or below 10,000, I would consider buying it because the valuation was pretty convincing at that price. But at the current price, I would not buy. So that's all for today. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, like, share and comment. If you have any other companies you want to analyze, put it in the comment. And thank you for watching and have a nice day.